Welcome back, guys. Shay from Microdex Mushrooms here over in the Plant Cell Technology Lab. Today we're going to be going over species-specific grow tips for lion's mane. We're going to be doing a bunch of different species, but we're going to start with lion's mane. It's one of my favorites. It's super easy to grow, so let's get started. One of the coolest things about fungi is how resilient they are. They always want to just fruit, so it makes our job really easy. They do most of the hard work. All we have to do is give them the right conditions and then they do the rest. So throughout the video, we're going to be looking at different ways of accomplishing the same goal, as is very common in mycology. There's no one right way of doing things. As long as we can keep our work clean and sterile and introduce our mycelium so that they can get in and colonize things, that's all we really want. So we're going to look at how to do that, starting with step one, the culture.
So this is Hericium erinaceus on a liquid culture. The liquid is only water and honey. The mixture I use is 1.5 cups of water to a tablespoon of honey. And the mycelium will last on this for well over a year, but it's suggested not to keep it on liquid culture too long. I would suggest either slanting it up or putting it on agar, which would look like this. And you can see this is exactly the same as the liquid culture, but the mycelium are growing across the surface of the agar. And you can see they actually have been sitting here so long that they've eaten their way down. So this is the lifespan of the mycelium. And they'll continue to eat down until they run out, but it looks like this little guy is trying to escape here. And he's going to keep trying to grow until he reaches right here, and he's going to try to grow out. So remember what I said before about the mycelium just wanting the fruit? This is what you get. And you can actually clone off of these little pieces that grow, and those should be clean since it's fresh growth. And here's another one. Now, lion's mane doesn't typically visually colonize the entire surface, but it is fully colonized. That's something to really keep in mind. You can see this one. While it doesn't seem like it's very colonized, it's just as colonized as this one. And you can tell because it's fruiting. And also the date on this, it's pretty old, but this is still a great culture to use. So once you have either your agar looking clean like this, or a clean liquid culture with strong connective tissue, although lion's mane tends to break apart really easily, it having good connective tissue is typically a good sign of healthy mycelium that doesn't have contamination. Just keep in mind also that you should do all of your contamination work, such as isolating any mycelium away from contamination. You should do that on agar, because once you go to liquid culture, it will be difficult to tell the difference between the two. While we're speaking about the importance of agar, Plant Cell Technology actually has their own agar on their website. You can use Microdex at checkout to save 10% on that if you want to go and grab some and get ready for the next step, which is going to be grain spawn. And we're going to jump into that now. We actually recently made a tutorial on how to do grain spawn and just to prep it and everything. We're going to go over it real quick here because it's not too difficult. All you need to do is soak your grain overnight. The next day, your grain should be more plump, maybe 2 to 3 times its original size. That's great. Your grain is now holding all the water necessary for the fungi to be successful in colonizing the grain. The next step is to drain your grain and make sure that there's no excess water on it. Excess water will cause your grain to overcook, similar to how rice can overcook if there's too much water in it. And that will crack the husk on your birdseed, which will lead to contamination later down the line. We want our moisture content to stay within each seed. Next up is to prep the actual mason jar lids. We're just going to drill two small holes and then cover those holes with micropore tape. The micropore tape allows for the gas exchange while the bird seed is in the pressure cooker, and so we don't crack our glasses. The holes will also serve a secondary function later. Once prepped, fill your jars halfway with bird seed. Don't exceed half. The reason that we're only doing half is if you want to do a grain to grain later, you'll have some room left in the jar, but we also need room in the jar for gas exchange. Putting too much content into your jars will likely lead to contamination because your mycelium will suffocate. So I would avoid going past half or three quarters, especially. Once you're all jarred up and your jars are pretty much ready to go, cover them all with foil and stick them in the pressure cooker for 2 hours at 15 PSI. If your grain is coming out of the fridge, if it's at room temperature, I would do an hour and a half. If it's at room temperature and then you cook it for 2 hours, it will likely burst and cause a nasty mess inside of the jar. So go with the hour and a half, 2 hour method, and you should be good to go. Once your pot is cooled, it is now time to inoculate your grain with your mycelium to create grain spawn. If inoculating using agar, all you need is a visible sample. And if you're using a liquid culture, then you would use 2 cc's per jar. So from a 10 cc syringe, you should be getting at least 5 inoculations. If you need to test your liquid culture that's inside of your syringe, only use a half cc or 1 cc, because you don't want the liquid to run around on the plate too much. Be sure to remember to reseal your inoculation points with fresh micropore tape, and then you can give it a little spray of isopropyl alcohol just to make sure nothing sneaks its way in there. Once your inoculations are complete, we're just going to watch them for a few days and make sure that no contamination pops up. You should see full colonization within 10 to 14 days, so roughly 2 weeks. What works best for me is to just keep the colonizing jars inside of a dark room or just a dark place. You could even just put them inside of a box so no light interferes with them. Light is one of the fruiting conditions, so it's a bit of a distraction for the mycelium to colonize while there's light present. So keep them in the dark, keep them in a cool room. The less you touch them, the better. This jar is a very extreme example of full colonization. You can see the mycelium have completely taken over. And if you just give this a quick shake, you can see that this is actually just grain spawn, tightly packed by mycelium. So this is more than ready to go on to the next stage, which is being introduced to bulk substrate, which would be wood in this case. These are hardwood oak pellets, and we are going to be hydrating these to field capacity, which is about 60%. So we're going to use 5 cups of the oak pellets to 6 cups of water. And then we're just going to mix this up until all the water is absorbed and there's none sitting at the bottom of the bucket. Super easy. And then we're going to jar all that up. We can fill these jars all the way up and then sterilize these for 2 hours. When your substrate is good and cool, you can combine both your grain spawn and your substrate that you just made. This is pretty much the final stage before fruiting. You can start to get really creative here. You don't have to put your substrate and your grain spawn combination into a bag. You can put them into flower pots. You can put them in bottles, plastic. You can put in anything that can create a seal so that they can colonize the substrate, and then they're going to start looking to fruit. They're going to look for fruiting conditions. So here I'm going to show a couple of examples of how you can make a more traditional fruiting block by combining substrate and grain spawn. We also did the same exact thing, but we put some of the mixture back into the jar it came from so that we could watch the lion's mane grow from the jar as well. Colonization works very much the same as it did at the grain spawn level, but it works a lot faster because now our mycelium are living on an energy source that they're going to use to colonize the substrate. So it's going to be a lot faster than 2 weeks, but typically you would want to wait 2 weeks just to let them colonize and then establish themselves within the substrate so that they can fruit even better. Don't forget to label your species name and the date of inoculation and maybe even the ratio that you use so you can see what the results of that experiment turn into. This is about 2 to 3 weeks after the inoculation of the jar that you just saw being made, and you can see it's fully colonized. It's super foggy in there. It's not as brown as it was, and you can see the mycelium are just going crazy in there because they're ready to fruit. When it looks like this, it's time for fruiting. And pretty much all you need to do is give them a little bit of air and a little bit of humidity. And then you'll get something more like this. Here you can see the lion's mane. It doesn't have its most known characteristics in its morphology. Typically you'd see it more like this. The reason for the difference in morphology is mostly due to the air in this case. So in a closed bag, they have more restricted air, so they will cover more ground to get to air so that they can grow more densely to create a denser fruiting body to make spores to get carried away in the wind. That's why fungi try to fruit in open air and not so much in a closed container. The benefits of growing in a closed container, though, is you don't have to deal with spores inside of your home if you're planning on growing indoors. And that's a really big takeaway. You can also keep the lion's mane fruiting for a longer period of time, maybe even up to 3 months, 2 months-ish, depending on how much space they have in the bag. When you side fruit a lion's mane, it'll fruit for 5 to 7 days-ish, and then it'll start to decay. But if you fruit inside of a bag, it'll be fruiting for that entire duration, and then you can just decide when to pull it. The longer you wait, the better the yield. So less maintenance.
Yeah, guys, that concludes my notes on lion's mane. For the most part, there are a lot of situational things that can happen, obviously, but if you guys have any questions, just drop them down in the comments. But I will see you all in the next one. Oh, and do not forget to check out the Plant Cell Technology Store. Of course, you get 10% off using the code MICRODEX. Grab yourself some agar. You never know when you're going to run into a nice specimen that you want to culture. Yeah, we'll see you guys next time. Have a good one. Take care.